special session on differential altitudes, where you can see the information here. So people should be aware of this for this coming spring AMS meeting. There's also a DART 8, which will, the dates are given over there. So there's additional information on the board on your left that you might be interested in. Just a second.
Okay, that's it. And also, if you had a poster, please take them today. We're going to be someplace else tomorrow, and what's left will not exist for very much longer. So, are you ready to go? So let me introduce Anand Pillay.
Thank you very much. I'm going to use the blackboard. Do we have enough chalk here, otherwise? Oh, we have chalk here. Now, William said you wanted to take a picture of this.
No, I did already.
I can erase it?
Yeah.
So, using the blackboard. And I want to start off by just giving my... It's nice to talk on this day, which is devoted, which is in honor of Phyllis, Cassidy, and William Sitz. And just my appreciation to both of them for their academic contributions, which will be actually connected, especially Phyllis, connected very much with what I thought about. And also for carrying on this culture tradition. You know, I met culture only once in...
I was wondering.
It was in the ex-Soviet Union, the former Soviet Union. There was this meeting, Malted meeting 89. Oh. And we sat at the same table. And I said hello or something. But anyway, if you could just continue on this fantastic tradition that we started with, I think it's continuity in the next. So that's one thing. I should mention that the left-hand board is this meeting on differential Cohomology theory and algebra at the Fields Institute. You just meet myself, Rahim, and Mikhail Vidner are organizing. So what I want to do is I want to try and prove a theorem. You know, that's not that. Can we do this?
It's an F conference. It's an appropriate place.
It's permissible. I'm going to try and bring it through. So there's a very nice workshop, which is a very inspiring workshop we had. There was one in April and May. It was put on by Alexei and Paris and I made a talk. I made some claims. I claimed some things. I want to prove it. Okay? I'm going to try and prove it. It's not rocket science, it's the strength of biology. So I'm going to prove this theorem, okay, that I stated. And I'll first state the theorem, I'll give corollary, a few remarks, and I'll give try and sketch a proof. Okay, that's just. We're working one derivation, and the theorem is. The theorem is let K be a differential field. Okay. Then K is both algebraically closed and PV, Picard-Vessiot closed. This is such a Picard-Vessiot, there are lots of acronyms in this talk. PV closed. If and only if the H1 constrained cohomology KG is trivial for all linear differential algebraic groups G defined over K. This is, I will say, I'll try to define all these objects. This is Colchin's constrained cohomology, which was constrained is because of constrained closure. This is differential Galois cohomology. Because Galois cohomology is about action of the absolute Galois group of the field on the points of the group, algebraic group. this is the same thing, but instead of the algebraic closure, differential closure. And they call it constrained closure. So constraint. This is, and it's in Colchin's, which book is it in? It's Algebraic Groups book. Where's this done? Where's this chapter on constraintology? Is it in the algebraic group, in different algebraic groups book?
Yes. Okay, so this is second book.
I'll explain what things mean, okay? There'll be quite a few acronyms in this talk. There'll be DGT, there'll be DAV, there'll be DAG, there'll be LDAG, there'll be PHS, and there'll be CCCP, okay? Differential gamma theory, differential algebraic varieties, differential algebraic groups, differential algebraic groups, it's also called torsor. PHS is a torsor for an algebra group. Okay, it's a copy of the group without the one. And so comments first of all. Corollary is the existence and uniqueness of PPV extension when the DX constants this is PPV theory with DXDT, two.
Okay.
When the DX constants are algebraically closed and PV closed from the point of view of DT. Okay? So uniqueness of PPV extensions and existence uniqueness. That's a fourth consequence. This depends, the existence is well known because by algebraic closure, I think Bidmer did this. I mentioned this last April, and then the uniqueness depends on classifying the PPV extensions by an H1 of the Galois group, which is the differential algebraic group, which is done implicitly in Alexei's paper. So like explicit or explicit, I'm not sure, but it's there. Okay, so I'm going to get comments.
PPV extensions are where?
Pardon?
Where?
Okay, so you're working in the context of dx/dt, and you have a linear differentiation in x.
Over k?
Yeah, so k is a given field. K will be now a dx/dt field.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then you have a differential equation over that in x, and then you have a uniqueness just if the constants, if the dx constants are nice. Right. So it's application. This is about one derivation. It's application of this to the PPV theory. Okay. Good. Comments. Number one is PV. So PV is Picard-Vessiot. So I'm assuming people know the Picard-Vessiot. Business. Okay? Is that okay? Picard-Vessiot business. No, Picard. You know, so an differential equation, the Picard-Vessiot extension is a field extension generated by fundamental system solutions for this without any new constants. That's the key point, without new constants. And some comments. So PV closed can mean two things. One is no proper PV extension. PV extension is always with respect to an linear differential equation. With respect to, or what can be any linear DE has already a fundamental system of solutions in K. So K PV closed can be one of two things. It's a formal definition, and that's a natural thing. These are generally different notions, but they're the same when the constants are algebraically closed. The same if CK is algebraically closed. So I'm putting in algebraically closed, okay? Yeah.
So then it's not this K.
what you're required, what your theory is requiring is that you have, look at a PPV problem or some field L.
Forget the PPV.
Forget the PPV.
This is just the chronology. I'm hoping without comments on this. There's one derivation of it anymore.
Yeah, but that's fine. But is your the situation where you're going to apply for its corollary over the field K over some bigger field L whose constants relative to various things are this field capital K?
No. K is my differential field.
It's the base field.
K is my differential, my base differential field.
Your equation is over K.
Equation over K.
Okay.
So K is PV closed.
So then how does
two possible
It doesn't matter.
I'm just saying, if I have time, I'll explain at the end. If I can't explain at the end, but I'm just saying it's a formal corollary, but using something, right? It's just not like a trivial, it's not tautological, it's not like in the words, you know, it's not a grammatical consequence, right? Okay, so first that, okay? This is ordinary case. I'm just saying simply there's two notions of the field being PV closed, possible notions. One is the formal thing, one is this thing, and they're the same as the constant algebraically closed. Okay. Number two also is that PV closed implies algebraically closed. Again, if the constants are algebraically closed. So you see this statement that an algebraic extension is a PV extension, but only when the constant algebraically closed. Okay, so this explains why I have this. And is there, and I need this algebraically closed to deal with finite algebraic extensions. I need that, to deal with finite groups, the triviality of cohomology finite groups. This is one thing. Number two, we work in the category DAV, differential of culture. So we're talking about isomorphism, etc. It's in the category of differential algebraic varieties. On the other hand, because we're talking about groups and their torsors, we can equally well work. So that's why I'm sort of using this kind of Trump. Equally well, we can work with the category. Sorry.
He repeats everything.
I know. Many things by these things. Too much television. So people, you can work in the category of definable sets. In GCF zero, or definability in the theory GCF zero. It's equivalent because you're working with groups and with groups of their torsors. Okay, so definable groups have a differential gradient. H1, what is H1? C, K, G, culture. Constrained cohomology, Galois cohomology. So here you have, instead of the algebraic closure of the field, you have the differential closure, and you have the co-cycles are certainly going to co-cycles from this automorphism of the differential closure to the points of the group G in that differential closure. And it's just descent, it's kind of descent data kind of stuff. And you say what kind of you know, in fact interesting thing, you know, ought co-cycles. This is actually not important, co-cycles are just cultural background. Ought. So A diff is differential closure. What kind of co-cycles? Well, definable co-cycles. So there's a certain okay, but the main thing, the important thing is that this classifies the PHS. It's what Mikhail was talking about, the difference case. Classifies PHSs for G over K, where G is any differential algebraic group. Any differential over K. Okay, so the this cohomology classifies up in that natural set up to isomorphism over K as a G torsor. Okay, so when we say that, I'm going to talk really quickly. When we say that this is trivial, so the conclusion, the right-hand side says that any PHS has a point. So the right-hand side says, so the right-hand side says, so RHS says, for any linear differential algebraic group over K and a PHS, differential algebraic PHS, for you don't know how this stuff works with the chalk.
If you just push it, it don't fall out.
Like this?
Yeah, sure.
PHS X and PHS X for G, X over K, X has a K point. The PHS is simply a definable set on which G is acting over, over K in a strictly transitive fashion. Has actually a point, okay? So that's true. This is the right hand side.
But Anand, these constraint cohomology is no longer the inverse limit of H1 of finite groups?
What?
This is no longer... So
no, no, in fact, a subtext here is what is the... is how do you view the differential closure of the... How do we view ought... How do we view this group?
It's not a group of finite.
What kind of group is... Well, it's not a profinite group, but what is it? What kind of group is it? It's not... Does it have any geometric structure? It doesn't have a geometric structure. It has this sort of Polish space where you give it's a topological group where the open things are fixated to finite sets, open subgroups, but so on. It's a big, but it's not actually interesting. But this differential closure has an interesting structure. There's a PV closure, and the PV closure is actually the inverse limit of algebraic groups. So if that part of its automorphism group has a And the main point of this statement here is that insofar as this double cohomology of linear differential algebraic is concerned, only the PV part of the differential closure is relevant, which is expected in some sense. Okay. So it says that the PV closure, not PV closure. I could the PV closure. Actually, I mean, you could look given a K. Differential closure, I can look at the maximal PV extension, or the unit PV extension, rather. And that is that extension is actually, water group is an inverse limit of algebraic groups, linear algebraic groups. So that so you replace finite by algebraic. But that doesn't take care of the whole automorphism group, because a lot of funny stuff goes on. And the funny stuff should not be relevant to geometric problems. That's the moral of the story, okay? okay, three, another comment is three. Another comment is three. Same theorem holds with, on the left hand side, K is algebraically closed and generalized strongly normal closed. This generalized strongly normal theory is the Galois theory given by the model theory point of view, which extends the Picard-Vessiot theory and the strongly normal theory. It's nothing to do with what Moore did, nothing to do with that. It's simply you deal with more equations. You have a Galois theory, and that's the generalized strongly normal theory, which I don't want to talk about really here. And the right-hand side is H1C, K, G is trivial for every DAG, not just linear, any differential algebraic. So this statement actually gives justification to looking at this generalized strongly normal. theory. It's a natural condition equivalent to a, well, it gives some reasonable looking at this.
Does it then be the same thing for the parameterized situation?
I guess so, yeah. Okay, that's it. Now, it's important in this theorem that what's interesting, you may think that this, really this, the main thing is about should we connect it, should we say something about finite dimension? By finite dimension, I mean differential dimension zero. But in fact, it's about all linear DAGs, even interdimensional DAGs, you can think, right? So that's a little interesting thing, maybe unexpected. And okay, so that's why this corollary is interesting, because the corollary, the PPB theory, involves possibly infinite dimension. Okay, so that's yeah, so let me try to sketch a proof. It uses a lot of ingredients, actually very straightforward, but uses lots of ingredients. A lot of little facts about the classification and description of the interdimensional groups. Phyllis, especially Phyllis.
Can I ask you something?
Yeah.
For this theorem, which of the PV calls are you, definitions are you going to
I'm saying they're the same.
You guys
are making
it your objects, basically.
It doesn't matter which one. So, inductive procedure. So, what's the situation? I'm given a linear differential algebraic group over K. I'm given a principle homogeneous space for G over K. We want to find a K point. Now, actually, motion, when I told motionless theorem, Kaminsky, he kind of said it was immediate, because any principle homogeneous space for LDAG should be the solution of a linear differential equation. Does anybody see that? Did anyone see that? I don't see it. Anyway, so you'll see, look at the proof here and see is it something immediate? I don't think it's immediate.
No.
But Moshe is. But that's how it is. So suppose you have. So I'm given, say, G, exact sequence, G, H, 1. Of an exact sequence over K of linear differential equations. I'm in the category of DAVS. Suppose we know for N and H, we know for G. We know the theorem for H and N, we know for G. So either this is by some exact sequence of the module, which I don't understand is exact sequences of any kind, actually, except maybe this. It's either by exact sequence of cohomology, or I just say what goes on. I've got X, a PHS for G. Now, from X, I over K, so the issue is over what? The parameters are crucial in this whole set. So I've got X over K for G. I get from this directly a y over h, a PHS y, just by taking y, the elements of y are the n orbits, okay? And this is defined over k. If y has a point, then this gives me that the pre-image is a PHS for n. The pre-image under the map here is a PHS for, is n for n. If that has a point, X of a point two. Okay, so you reduce this to dealing with H and N.
Sorry, why is it again?
Pardon?
Why? What is why?
That's what I just said. I'm going to be saying things which I don't write down. Okay, so this was the example. You take X, the PHS for G. Okay, G goes on to H. Over K, I get from this directly a PHS for H, Y. The points of Y are the N orbits inside X, orbits under N, and that whole thing is defined over K. So good. y defined over k. Once y is a point, I get a PHS for n defined over k. Maybe that point viewed as a subset of. And if that has a point in k, so does x have a point. So we reduce in this one. But that's the inductive procedure. Because of the inductive procedure, we are able to restrict ourselves to some very special cases by the inductive procedure. So we may assume, particularly we may assume G is connected. Connected means has no defined differential algebraic finite index on. Why? Because the algebraic G is algebraically closed, K is algebraically closed, so it has no finite extensions. Okay? In the case of finite G, just gives you an algebraic extension. Okay, now there's two cases. Case A, G is finite, what we call finite dimensional. I.e. differential dimension is zero. Or zero or more you rank, U rank, finite. Transcendence degree finite. So finite dimensional differential in the sense of Alex Green's book, finite dimensional differential.
So
you're dealing
with just one
parameter. Yeah, so that's
one,
that's the first case.
Ordinary.
So ordinary, yeah? So by the inductive procedure, so notice where these linear groups, you're inside some Zariski closure or whatever, inside GLN, and GLN you can decompose solvable, radical, semi-simple, okay? And so you can the solvable part is obtained by quotients which are additive or multiplicative group, etc. Semi-simple parts, quotients are simple. So you can reduce them by the inductive procedure. Procedure here, we can reduce to A. G is contained in additive group. B. G is contained in multiplicative group. C, G is simple, non-commutative. Okay, three cases. Just by the inductive procedure.
Why is that so?
Well, because
it
doesn't matter. You just take your group and you've got the maximal solvable radical. Either you can do it monothetically, you want to find a multi-rank group or whatever, or you just, this is living inside Zariski closure, and this closure has a decomposition into a solvable radical. This intersects everything inside with your group, and you end up with, the semi-simple, you've got solvable radical. So radical is decomposed into things where the quotients are additive and multiplicative group. Quotient of that is semi-simple. Semi-simple, in the sense of has no infinite abelian normal subgroup, and that's a direct product of simples. Or you can either do model theory, you work inside this risky closure. It's okay. Believe me, it's okay. So you can reduce to three cases. Okay, three cases. So in case A, well, I mean by your five-dimensional subgroup of GA is just it's already given by linear homogeneous equation, which defines a PV extension. So in case A, or there's also a theorem I could use, which I use more in the case of this four, is that there's a theorem in some DGTs. At this paper, DGT 1, 2, 3, and then I call argument 4, it's not called that title, but I call it DGT 4. So DGT 4, I prove that if you have two five-dimensional differential algebraic groups, which are isomorphic over the differential closure of K, then they're isomorphic over a PV extension. So this allows you to say that if two things are isomorphic over the differential closure, they're actually already isomorphic over K, which is my assumption. So this is, but in the specific cases I'm working with, I think I don't need that, I just work directly. So suppose G is in GA. Or okay, is given by linear, by calculus, is described by linear homogeneous equation. So it's already a PV extension, right? But, so in that case, G is a G, so,
yeah.
So you know, a basis, you know, so G defines, the solution base of G is a five-dimensional vector space over the constants. Name a basis, is a Picard-Vessiot extension, name a basis, so G is actually inside the constant. So you see that G is in the constants. We may assume G is inside the constants. In fact, G is a subgroup of subgroup of not GAC. It's going to be G is a subgroup of some G actually is an algebraic group. An algebraic group, linear algebraic group, inside a linear algebraic group, inside the constants.
You're looking at the first case?
Yeah. Let's say the first, in fact, the same works with the third case too.
What about the second?
I didn't say the second case yet. Okay, so G is in a group. And then, so G is living inside the constants. So X is a PHS for G. X defines a PV, defines a PV extension. Because so X is X defines a PV extension. X
you don't need to check that there are no new constants.
A PV, why a PV extension?
Yeah,
I
thought
that. Because why? Because X is a PHS for a linear algebraic group. It defines a strongly normal extension, but the Galois group is linear. So by Kolchin, it's a PV extension.
Yes.
Okay. Good. So finished. Okay.
Sorry. So K is, little K is not algebraically closed.
Pardon?
Little K is not algebraically closed.
What?
Little K.
Yes, little K is algebraically closed. Because K is algebraically closed, so little K is too. So I'm proving here right to left.
Okay.
I should say I'm proving right to left here. Sorry, I'm proving right to left here. Okay. Left and right, in other directions. I'm proving PV closed implies this is trivial.
Left to right.
So we're happy. We're happy in this case. In case C, it's similar. So G is simple. So we know that G is isomorphic over, means finished for anything. We know that G is isomorphic over K diff to a simple algebraic group in the constants, okay? But as I said, just as it's over a PV extension, therefore it's over K.
Right.
So similarly, in case C, similar. What about case B? Well, you could reduce case B to case A by using log derivative.
Hmm.
Use log derivative, and I map G into GA, and the kernel is in the constants of GA. Everything work out. Okay. Use log
derivative. Not necessarily. What do you mean?
So I've got G inside GM.
The kernel isn't the constant necessarily.
Pardon? It's inside the constant.
No. G doesn't have.
I'm thinking GM. I'm looking at Y. And you break it into something in GA and something in the constants, and everything works out. Okay.
Right.
So. Good. So we're happy. Something to say. He was saying, Michael was talking about the theory of happiness. Yeah? Theory of happiness and fine automata. So we're happy. For some strange reason, I'm teaching calculus this semester. I don't know how it happened.
But it's logical, is it?
What's your thesis gases? Why?
Logical?
What's logical?
Your thesis gases.
What's
your
logical? Okay, good.
What about case B?
So, this already proves that you have an equivalence. So I should say, you know, why is the other direction true? If K is not, say, PV closed, then you have a PV extension. That PV extension is got from a PHS for an algebraic group, which has no points. So this direction, the other direction is also typically that. So
why does it have no point?
Pardon? Suppose you have...
I mean, what if k is c of x?
Suppose you have... suppose k has a proper PV extension. Let's suppose it's algebraically closed. If it's not algebraically closed, you have an algebraic extension. And you get a contradiction with g of finite.
I see. So if it ha- if it's algebraically closed, okay.
So case B, general. General G. So by case A, an inductive procedure plus the inductive procedure, we may assume G is what we call one connected. So connected means has no finite non-trivial quotients, right? One connected means has no five-dimensional non-trivial quotients. Because if you had such a thing, you could use inductive procedure to deal with the finite. Okay, so it doesn't matter. If you had a finite dimensional quotient, you could deal with the, you could look at the, you could use case A to deal with that, and then you reduce to the kernel, which is connected, which is one connected.
So one connected, would you say it in like that?
One connected means, so connected is zero connected, so let's do it like this. One connected means has no non-trivial, finite dimensional quotients.
Is that what we call strongly connected?
Strongly connected is okay. Strongly connected.
And because we're in, because
we're
strong in, connected is not strongly connected.
Let's call it one. In fact, one connected is the model theory. It's actually a model theory. Differential, but it makes perfect sense in differential.
Yeah.
So one connected, and the U rank, if you want the U rank.
Yes, it's stronger.
U rank of G is something like omega times N for people. This doesn't imply one connected, does it?
Doesn't imply one connected.
Yes, it does. Why? Because it has a Fokian extension. It's orthogonal to anything of finite rank. Yeah, of course, this implies this equivalently equals U rank plus connected. Yeah, so one connected exactly means U rank is a polynomial and the group is connected. Okay, for model theory, for the model theory brothers and sisters, for model theory comrades. Good. So what do I do? What do we do now? So we can assume it's one connected. And again, by the inductive procedure, you'll lift G is now in GLN, you can reduce to same thing. G is living in GA, GM, or G is simple. Now you should say almost, I mean, in fact we should say almost simple, it's a delicate matter. But if it's almost simple, you know the kernel, I mean, even without using what Andre and Jim did, even without using that, almost simple, the kernel is going to be five-dimensional using again the exact, using again the inductive procedure. So one doesn't need to use Andre and Jim's kernel. Anyway, you can reduce to the case, reduce to G is inside additive group. This is by using the decomposition of this risky closure, which is an algebraic group, linear algebraic group. G inside Gn, or G is simple non-commutative.
What about G? Why not G?
Pardon?
Why not G?
Yeah, I'll say that in a second. So in case A and B, you're forced to have equality. In case A and B, if G is a one connected subgroup of GA, it has to be GA. So A and B, G equals GA, additive group, B, G equals GM. And what do we use? These are algebraic groups. So either we now deal with algebra, now G is actually an algebraic group. It's an algebraic group. And in fact, in this case, it's probably very easy, but for algebraic groups, you have Colchin's theorem, which says that if it's K is algebraically closed. So when G is a G algebraic group, connected algebraic group, for the K, and we have Colchin. Colchin's theorem that H1, C, G, K, G is true. As K is algebraic groups. So Colchin's theorem says you take an algebraic group. So there's some content there. It's not like, I wouldn't say it's a complicated theorem. I mean, there's it's not a complicated theorem. You just, from a differential algebraic PHS, you build an algebraic PHS or something. It's not a complicated theorem to do, but use Colchin, yeah?
So if G wasn't one connected, I mean, you're gonna start doing a Khrushchevsky decomposition?
Why Khrushchevsky? What Khrushchevsky is it?
Because there's gonna be something like omega plus parada. I mean, you're going to write that you rank as something times plus a finite?
No, nothing. You simply, if it's not one connected, then it maps on to a finite dimensional quotient. I use the inductive procedure. I use case A to deal with this.
But how do you know that it... So, it maps meaning over K?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Over K. Well, okay, yeah, over K, because if that's a good point, definitely. You know, so G will have a one connected component.
And it's...
And by canonicity is defined over the same. Oh, so that's an important point, actually.
Okay.
The one connected component is defined over K. So that's a really, I should have said that. So, obviously, okay. Now, KC, G is simple. And in fact, you know, what you could reduce to, we can get by just to G's living in G, G's over K, living in GLN. I can take Zariski closure, quotient by stuff. And you end up getting the G. You can get G Zariski dense in some G bar simple algebraic group over K. Just by taking Zariski closure quotient by stuff all over K all the time. And then Phyllis's theorem says G equals G bar. Phyllis's theorem, so we use Phyllis's theorem. Says G, if you have one connected, if you have a simple, not finite dimensional, different algebraic group, Zariski dense in a simple algebraic group, but equals the simple algebraic
group. Well, it's conjugate over.
What?
Conjugate.
No, it's equal to it.
Wait,
infinite dimensional. Oh, G bar.
Infinite dimensional, G equals G bar.
Right.
Not finite dimensional. G equals G bar.
Yeah,
again,
we
use Cauchy.
G equals G bar. Yeah.
Okay, so that's, I think this is like it.
Yeah.
That's infinite. Yeah, finish. Good. I should finish that, shouldn't I?
Sorry. Yeah.
Yeah? There's... I want to actually, is it possible to say two more remarks?
Sure.
A couple of remarks. One remark is, one problem is to formulate and prove analogues in the difference case. Formulate and prove, okay, in a different situation, what is going on. Second problem is to formulate the generalization to several commuting derivations. The right-hand side is very clear. G should simply be a linear differential algebraic group with several commuting derivations. What is the left-hand side? What are the extensions you're dealing with? Well, I don't know. It should include the PPV business, but maybe you should be talking about you know, things controlled by the constants, by relative constants. You know, so Landesmann theory, linear Landesmann theory. So it's analogy to the constants by a linear group. So maybe that's the right thing on the left hand side. I'm not sure. Okay, so there should be a theorem, and then you've got to prove it, you've got to generalize. It shouldn't be complicated, it should be interesting but complicated.
Would you say that again? I missed.
So for several derivations, the right hand side is clear what you mean.
Right.
What is the left hand side?
Right.
Well, maybe it's Landesmann's theory, but linear Landesmann.
Isn't
linear.
That just the PPV?
It's not PPV. Is it PPV? Maybe it's more general than PPV. You have something internal. You have something internal to the constants, to some constants.
Oh.
Okay. you turn the point 3 cents, and the group is a linear group. It's a linear group rather than an arbitrary function. Okay, that's second point. Third point is that I mentioned this. I mentioned four. I mentioned the same thing holds here. And in fact, I kind of claimed this in this paper called DGT2. I claimed that without. I made an implicit claim because I was talking about something else, but it was implicitly claimed there. But with a model theory proof involving the triangular dichotomy theorem and everything. But in fact, the same proof here works for this, to prove this, where there's an additional case in the decomposition where G is living inside an abelian variety. You have to deal with that case too, and Manning kernels come in, etc., but you could deal with that. So the same proof with additional case of an abelian variety in place of GAGN deals with that thing too. Okay.
So there's time for one quick question.
How do you prove the corollary?
You do it because you do it. Okay, see. You do it. The corollary is proof why. First of all, we have two derivations, dx dt. Simply, k dx dt, okay, dx dt, yeah. I've got this linear differential equation in dx. K is now dx dt. I'm looking at the dx constants of k. How do you write dx constants of k? What's the notation of dx constant?
After dx.
Yeah.
Oh,
dx.
Yeah.
Dx. Now dt field. Okay. If this is algebraically closed, dt field, then we know there exists a PPD extension by the theorem of Pillay. Okay. Okay, so this is now a dt field that's like my k over here. That's my k. It's this one, it's the dx constants. If it's PD closed, no, so, okay, sorry. Kdx. Now, so there is, so given this linear differential equation, the PPD type equation, parametrized equation over this, there is a PPD extension. And the Galois group of this is a linear differential algebraic group inside the differential closure. It's a linear D. Okay? But the general theory, which Alexei, you know, is implicit in the paper, says that the PPV extensions are classified by the constrained cohomology of that group. And that's trivial, so there's just one. By the theorem, it's trivial. I'm assuming this to be PD closed and algebraic closed. Okay, that explains it. So this goes via the fact that if there is a Galois extension, then the other ones are classified by H1. In the strongly normal version that we did with Kaminsky, H1 is, you know, things are classified by the connected components of some group where there's no you know, it's not H1 anymore, there's something else.
I was thinking if you change the situation where the group is defined by partial differential equations, more than one dt.
Yeah.
You're going to do with this induction step.
Yes, I
what do. What condition would you put on g to replace one index?
Yeah, I don't. I didn't think about it, but it's an interesting question. But in several directions, you have one connect, two connect, three. You
have different
do you have that to an number? Yes, exactly. The U rank is going to be at most. The U rank will be less than equal omega to the m times, right? And we have one to n to n. And U rank, it's the same thing. Yeah, okay, so this, I'm just saying, it's a problem, I didn't say I could do the problem, it's an interesting problem, which involves describing linear differential algebraic groups in, in a big, I would say it's a nice problem, to think what it's about, what's going on in the show. Okay?
Okay, well, thank you, and we'll meet again tomorrow.
Yeah, I did. He's a turnover. He's a turnover.